So let's stand to our feet. We're going to say the blessing for the Talit and honor God with this covering. It represents that covering over our lives, that blessing. Let's say the Hebrew blessing together. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Kidshanu B'Mitzvotav B'Tzivanu Lehitatet Batzitzi. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who sanctified us with his commandments, has commanded us to have ourselves. Prepare our hearts for the call to worship through the sound of the shofar. We call forth our shofar blowers today.
At this time, Don BenYa'akov will sound the shofar as we give now our blessing, the sound of the shofar.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Kidshanu B'Mitzvotav B'Tzivanu. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with his commandments, commanded us to hear the sound of the shofar. Amen. We thank you, Lord God, for your goodness. You are Avinu Malkeinu, our Father. You are our King. We thank you, Lord God, as we crown you as King, King of the universe. We thank you that you have given us Messiah Yeshua to be King of kings and Lord of lords. One day he will take up his rightful throne, and the Lion of the tribe of Judah has prevailed. And Father, we thank you, Lord God, he's come first as a suffering serpent, as a lamb that was slain, but he's coming back as a roaring lion, as a king. Father, we thank you for the promise you gave David, that there will always be a son to sit upon his throne. And may he establish it with righteousness and justice forever. Father, we pray in our lives, Lord God, that he would be upon the throne of our hearts. Search us, God, if there's any wicked way in us. Clean our heart today, Lord God. Create in us a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit within us. Allow us to give you a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of our lips giving thanks to God today. And we thank you on this day, your Shabbat, that we will enter into your rest, that we will refrain from any words negative about the promised land as the spies, the 10 spies spoke, but we would also be like Joshua and Caleb, not only to speak good of the land, but to enter into all the promises that in the Messiah are yes and amen. We want to possess the land of promise. We pray for every Jewish person that you are bringing back to the land of their forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And the promise that you gave is an eternal covenant forever to the sons and daughters of Abraham. We thank you, Lord God, because of that. We came out of Egypt. Because of that, you took us to Sinai. Because of that, you gave us the Torah. Because of that, you brought us into the land. And Father, it's enough to say Dayenu. But Father, we thank you for all sufficiency that we have in Yeshua the Messiah today. In his name we pray. B'Shem Yeshua. Amen.
Amen.
At this time, I'd like to ask if there's anyone who's in the need of the Kaddish, the mourner's Kaddish. Anybody who's experienced the loss of a loved one, or if also if you're remembering anybody. And as I remember right now, I got a call from my mom the other day. It was on Thursday. One of my cousins, he passed away. It was a year ago. I saw him at my second cousin's funeral. If you remember Yolanda from Destiny, her niece, that was from last year, but this year, sadly, my cousin passed away.
Wow.
So, you know, we don't know when they're going to have a viewing or the burial, but I would like to give a render for today.
Also for the female IDF soldier.
Oh, yes. Yes. Yeah.
Hadada Cohen?
Cohen, mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes.
Rosalyn would like her brother Ruben to be
remembered. Okay, yes. Yard Bates for him, to a remembrance of him. And as we always remember, and today we'll understand more about God and the fact that he judges, and Kaddish comes from Kadosh. Let's always remember that God is holy. Be ye holy, for I am holy. And for that, he's the only one who can actually judge us. And with that, I give you the Kaddish. Yitkadah v'yitkadash shame rabba v'elmadi v'achirute v'yamlich malchute v'chayechon uv'yomechon v'chayedechon v'Yisrael v'ahagala v'ahagala uv'izman kari v'yimeru amen. Yehesh me rabba me vorach, me'olam olme olmaya, yiparach, yiparach, ve'yishtabach, ve'yipar ve'yroman ve'yinase, ve'yihadar ve'yihale, ve'yihalal, shmei dikudisha brichu, le'le mikol berchata, ve'shirahata, tush ve'chata, ve'nechemata, damin rambama, ואימרו אמן. יש למה רבה משמיה, וחיים עלינו ועל כל ישראל. ואימרו אמן. עושה שלום במרמיו, הוא יעשה שלום עלינו ועל כל ישראל. ואימרו, אימרו אמן. Glorified and sanctified be his great name in the world which is created according to his will. May he cause the reign of his kingdom in your lifetime and in your days, and in the life of all the house of Israel, speedily, yes, soon. And let us all say, Amen. May his great name be blessed forever and forever eternally. Blessed and praised, glorified and exalted, extolled and honored, adored in God, in the name of the Holy One, blessed be he who is high above all. All blessings and hymns and praises and consolations which are spoken in the world. And let us all say, Amen. May there be great peace from heaven and life for us and for all of Israel. And let us all say, Amen. He who makes peace in the heavenly realms, may he make peace for us and for all of Israel. And let us all say, Amen. And we have the words of a messianic encouragement. Be not afraid of sudden terror, nor of the storm that strikes the wicked. Do your scheming, and shall not succeed. Make your plan, and shall not prevail. For God is with us. Even in your old age will I be the same. When your hairs are gray, I will sustain you still. I have created you, and I will carry you. I will sustain you and save you. And at this time, let us unite our hearts, bring our hearts together as we give the declaration of the Shema.
Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu. Adonai Echad, Baruch Shemo Malchuto Le'olam Vayed.
Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. Blessed be his Lord, his name, his kingdom is forever and ever. Amen.
Ve'ahavta et Adonai Elohecha, v'chol levavcha u'v'chol nafshecha u'v'chol me'odecha. Ehayu hademorim haele, asher anochi metzavecha, ayom alevavecha, v'shinatam levanecha, v'divartam, v'shivtecha v'beitecha, uletecha v'aderech, u'v'shofecha u'kumecha, u'kshartam le'ot adecha, ehayu letotafot v'inenecha, וכתבתם על מזוזות ביתך ובהי שעריך. Amen.
And you shall love the Lord your heart, with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. Let these words that I command you today be upon your heart. Teach them thoroughly to your children, and speak of them while you sit in your home, while you walk on the way, when you retire, and when you arise. Bind them as a sign upon your arm, and let them be frontlets between your eyes. And write them on the doorposts of your house and upon your gates. Amen.
Ve'ahavta le'recha kamocha,
and you shall love your neighbor as yourself.
Amen.
And at this time, we shall bring the Torah scroll from the Aron HaKodesh as we give the blessing of Ein Kamocha. There is none like you.
Ein Kamocha ba'Elohim Adonai v'yein kemasecha. מלכותך, מלכות כל עולמים, וממשלתך בכל דור ודור. Adonai Melech, Adonai Malach, Adonai Yimloch, Leolam Ba'el, Adonai Oz, Leomo Yitein, Adonai Yivarech, Et Amo Vashalom. Ahav Rachamim, Etiva Bertzoncha, Et Zion. Tivne Chomot, Yerushalayim, Ki Lecha, Levad Batachnu, Melech Era Ben Isa, Adon Olamim.
There is none like you, O Lord, among the gods that are worshipped, and there are no deeds like yours. Your kingdom is forever. You reign through all generations. The Lord reigns. The Lord will reign forever and ever. O Lord, give strength to your people. O Lord, bless your people with peace. Father of compassion, deal kindly with Zion, according to your will. Rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, for we trust in you alone, O King, revered and honored God, Master of the entire universe. Amen.
ויהי בצו אהרון, ויאמר משה, קומה אדוני, ויפוצו אויביך, וינוסו משנאיך מפניך, כי מציון תצא תורה, כי מציון תצא תורה, ודבר אדוני מירושלים. Baruch Shenatan Torah Torah, Baruch Shenatan Torah Torah, Le'amo Israel, Yidushato.
And when the ark would travel, Moses would say, Arise, O Lord, and let your enemies be scattered, and let them flee from before your face. For from Zion will go forth the Torah, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. Blessed be he who gave the Torah to his people Israel in his holiness. Amen. Baruch Adonai HaMevarach.
Baruch Adonai HaMevarach Le'olam Ba'ed.
Baruch Adonai HaMevarach Le'olam Ba'ed.
Baruch Atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam. Asher bachar banu mikol ha'amin, benatan lanu et torato. Baruch atah Adonai, noten ha'torah. Amen.
Bless the Lord, the blessed one. Blessed the Lord, the blessed one for all eternity. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who chose us from all people and gave us the Torah. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Amen.
Well, I'd like to ask, or rather say, Boker Tov and Shabbat Shalom to everybody here. Mm-hmm. Is there anyone who is here for the very first time?
Yay!
Oh, we've got two young people, hey! We've got a little warm welcome right here. Which, by the way, Yada and Yadot, well, guess what? That's going to be spoken of today in today's portion of Mishpatim. So, if you'd like to come on up. And anyone else, of course, family.
You want to share with me what Yada means?
Oh, yeah, well, in this case, for children.
Boys
and girls. So we've
Yadah is girl and Yadot is girls.
And today we're going to be actually speaking about that as far as today's portion of Mishpatim. And if anyone else would like to come on up to the reading table at this time, please do so. And to the members of the congregation, students of the Hebrew class.
And what's your name?
Connie.
Connie, great to have you with us.
Billy.
Billy, Connie and Billy. Let's give it up for Connie and Billy today. Okay, they live in Moreno Valley, but visit their dad here. Well, we're glad to have you and let you join our family here at Simchat Yeshua. So, young Mishpachim, huh? Oh, Thea brought them. Yes, wonderful. I love that. Thea came out of the hospital and she brought visitors. That's the way to do it, right? It's like we're coming out of Egypt, let's take everybody into the promised land. I love it.
Right,
so we just learned the first line of that portion in our Hebrew class. So members of the Hebrew class, if you want to come see what you just saw on the board today, you can come see it actually in the Hebrew text. So I want to make sure that you have an invite to come.
Also, and if they didn't see the 10 words last week.
Oh, the 10 words are also here. If you haven't seen the 10 commandments or the 10 words, if you'd like to see that, come and stand on either side of us. Try not to come in the front, but just either on, around on my left or my right.
10 commandments, 10 words. It's very hard to look, it's very hard to read. So I'm just reciting a little bit from the 10 words right here. I'm the Lord your God.
So the special markings that you see the spacing here is to indicate something unique in the text. So there's all this special breaks in between to show you in between each command or prohibition what God was speaking from Mount Sinai. And so we call them the 10 words because that's exactly what they're called in the Hebrew tongue of the Torah. And we get a translation of Ten Commandments. It's not actually correct because there are not Ten Commandments in the Torah. There's 613 commandments that probably could be all encapsulated in 10 folders. So in other words, there's many things in relationship to the Sabbath and many ways to take God's name in vain. Even doing a transaction, a business transaction, where you have an unfair balance in your transaction of monies and you do it in the name of God, you're misrepresenting his name. So you're making his name void because you're robbing him of his truthfulness when you say this is done in the name of God and it was incorrect.
You're raising up his name.
Huh? Raising up his name for vanity. Or in other words, saying, yeah, you know, I make a vow or I do this. That's why the Bible says not to swear or make a covenant in vanity, meaning that let your yes be yes, your no be no. Because if you say you're going to do something, you do it, say, in the name of the Lord, I'm going to do this, and you don't do it, you're making him a liar, because he's supposedly backing up your words, and you're not following through to back up his. So that's what it actually means not to swear. It doesn't mean you can't actually make a covenant. It means that don't do it in vanity. So let's go ahead and take a look at this week's portion. I have to roll the scroll a little bit. Not much.
So any more study? Anything that we can give for the kids?
I think they're good. Other than the meaning of the use of that pointer. This is in Hebrew, a yad, but it's the Hebrew word hand. And the reason we have the yad there is we don't use our real hands to touch the scroll. We touch it with the yad, the pointer. And that's because the oils in our skin can damage the scroll, and out of respect for God's word, we do not touch the scroll. That's why we use the handles to move it around. And it's made out of kosher animal skin. So it's like a form of leather or parchment that they're making out of animal skin. Very, yes, kosher means clean, that's fit for use, in other words. And so basically this scroll is about 125 years old. So in the world it would be an antique already, right?
Yeah.
It's funny because when you think of the New Testament, it was written 2,000 years ago. That's an antique also, isn't it? For many people, the Bible period is an antique. But when you read the scroll, we read from right to left, and there's no chapter or verse that's listed in the Torah scroll, guys. So take a look over here. You see the little spaces? The one that opens all the way out to the end of that column is called a petucha, which means a door opening, like a open door to the corridor or hallway. And then the one that closes in like a mouth is called a stuma. So that's the only way to know that we've come to the end of a paragraph or the end of a section or the end of the whole Torah reading for that day. So what we do is we look for a significant break and look for the next words to see if it's the beginning of the words we want. So when you read the Bible, starting from Genesis to Deuteronomy, you're actually reading a portion each week and we pick up what we left off. Okay, so last week's portion was Yitro, which was Jethro in the Bible, who heard the testimony of how God delivered Moses and the children of Israel out of Egypt. Okay, so this week is going to start in Exodus 21, verse 1, and it's going all the way to 24:18, and it's called Mishpatim. So that means the rulings of a judge. We would call them righteous or rational rulings of a judge. They make sense. And when the gavel comes down and the judge makes the decision, it's set in stone, and that's what God's commandments are like. Many of them are mishpatim. There's another category called hukim, which are divine decrees. Those are commandments that we don't always understand why God asks us to do them, but we do it anyway, because they're a divine decree from God. the rational rulings actually make sense to us. Like, oh, okay, that makes sense. Okay, I'm not going to steal my brother's stuff, okay, because I don't want someone to steal my stuff. So, you know, basically the concept is something that makes sense to us. All right? Like civil laws. Very good. So let's take a look at this portion. And our cantor today in Hebrew is Chazan. Mordechai is going to read the Hebrew, but he's going to actually sing it. So you're going to hear a melody to it.
ואלה המשפטים אשר תשים לפניהם כי תגנה עבד עברי שש שנים יעבוד ובשביעית יצא לחופשי חינם אם בגפו יבוא בגפו יצא אם בעל אישה הוא ויצא אשתו אמו אם אדוניו ייתן לו אישה וילדה לו בנים או בנות האישה וילדיה תהיה לאדוניה והוא יצא בגפו ואם אמור יאמר העבד אהבתי את אדוני את אשתי ואת בניי לא אצא חופשי והגישו אדוניו אל האלוהים והגישו אל הדלת או אל המזוזה ורצה אדוניו את אוזנו במרצע ועבדו לעולם.
Right.
So.
Yeah, that's a good one right there. That's a great teaching all by itself.
Oh.
So why don't you give us some highlights of what the text is saying?
Okay, in this case, as Rabbi was speaking about Mishpatim, Shafat is a judge, Shoftim is also judges.
So you'll know the name Jehoshaphat. Yehoshaphat. So Yah, the Lord, is judge. That's what his name means. And he was a righteous king, wasn't he?
Yes.
So that's beautiful.
So we have, and these are the judgments or rulings that are to be placed before them, in this case, all of Israel. And it speaks about the fact that if you buy a Jewish slave, he's only supposed to work for you for 6 years, and on the seventh year, he needs to be let go.
What does that mean to buy a slave? Was God promoting slavery?
No, he wasn't.
Okay, so what was the purpose of the indentured servant? If you owed a debt, you could pay it off by working for the person that's technically buying you for a time period to pay off a debt. And you're working out an agreement that after these many years, the debt will be cleared. And so you're going to work off the debt you owe. And so it wasn't slavery like we think in American history, with African-American slavery. It was actually referring to you volunteering to work off a debt. Because if not, you just spend time in jail. So you kind of would opt for, okay, I'll work for you, I'll pay that debt off. And so it was a voluntary thing. Yeah, community service, right? You're working off a debt that is owed. Okay, so let's continue on there. So only 6 years?
6 years only.
The seventh is a rest. So the Sabbath is the model for the 6 years you work, because God created the world in 6 days, and on the seventh day he rested. Today is the seventh day, so we rest in his rest. So the slave must rest also after 6 years. He's going to rest the seventh. And it's funny, the debt gets canceled. Do you ever think about bankruptcy and how we modeled that from the scriptures, that in 7 years it falls off? That's where we got it from, was the Bible. And so if you times those 7 years by another seven, seven times seven equals 49, that next year is the 50th. What is that called?
Jubilee.
So not only every seven times 7 years do you set captives free, but in the seventh times 70th year, or after the next year, the land goes back to the original owner if it was sold into slavery also. So you can think of from Adam to the time Messiah comes. Does anybody know how many jubilees that is? It's 120. 6,000 years. So it will be 120 jubilees. I think of the 120 that in Solomon's temple that couldn't stand to minister, and I think of the 120 in, we always say the upper room, but really, if anything, it was the upper room of the temple. It was the house of God that the miracle happened, the Holy Spirit coming on them with like cloven tongues of fire. And 120, it's kind of like 10 times the 12 tribes.
So you can see how beautiful that is, that God's going to fulfill 120 jubilees from creation to set the captive free and the land free, because the curse of on Adam came upon the whole world.
Right.
It's a beautiful picture there. Okay.
Now I want to get to the fact that, of course, you know, usually a key can go, and if he was married, one of the things we have to keep in mind is that his wife leaves with him. But if his lord gives him a woman, and they have kids and whatnot, well, the woman who is considered a Gentile woman, and the kids stay with the that was reading that.
But the text doesn't necessarily say that, right?
The text, yeah.
So, it's clarify, awesome. it's referring to rabbinic tradition. So, I always like to make sure people know that. Because in the text, it just says a girl.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, in other words, if you were a part of the house, you stay a part of the house. Which is exactly the ceremony going on with the servant that it shows in a second there that he's going to, if he can leave after the 6th year, or if he wants to remain part of the household, there was a ceremony to pierce his ear or to nail it to the door. And it obviously was just a ceremony. It kind of that piercing meant you belong to the house. And funny, because we still pierce ears today, don't we? The question is, what are we piercing them for? This was a ceremony which is significant of belonging to the household that you're connected to. Yes.
Does that mean you're part of that?
Abraham's servants were a part of his family. He treated all his servants like sons, and even as a father, they would call him master, just like his wife would call him Adoni, Lord, or master. So yes, they are a part of the household, because Eliezer, the head servant, would have been the son of inheritance, with the inheritance, if he had not had Isaac to take on the inheritance of his household. So yes, they are a part of the household.
And I want to mention right here that one part that I saw in this line, that when he is to go, the Lord, the master is supposed to bring, in this case, the servant unto the, it says, El Ha'elohim, unto really the judges. And
so usually Elohim is translated, gods, or it can be translated earthly gods, or in this case, strong ones, which could be the judges of Israel. So they're bringing them before the strong leaders. Because actually, Aleph and Lamed, El, can refer to the ox and the ox goad. So it's the leader leading or guiding the household. So the judges of Israel were called Elohim. So that's confusing when you read text where you're seeing, is God's, when Yeshua quoted the Psalms, it said, well, you are gods. He's saying, well, you are judges. You are people of great authority or power, and you're abusing it. Your sons of the Most High God, so he's giving you authority, but you've been abusing that authority, being unjust judges. He's not really calling them deities.
Amen. Yeah.
Again, that's a whole other study. But anyway, is that anything else?
And of course, he gets his ear pierced, and he shall be servant forever.
Yeah, so the word delet is door, like the word dalet. The letter dalet is the fourth letter in Hebrew, and it's a picture of a delet, a door. So guess who is the door in our life? Yeshua is the door. But it's an interesting thing, because over the door of our heart, over the doorpost, the blood was applied, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just like Israel had the blood of the Lamb on the doorpost, today this is our door. It's the door of entrance into our heart. So Yeshua's on the outside knocking, saying, let me in. Once he's in, then he's protecting the household.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Moses was the servant of God's house. Yeshua is the son over the house.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that a beautiful picture? Uh-huh. Same house, though, not two. One house.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so blessings of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob on all of you today. And you can be seated. Thank you. Let's give it up for the first-time guests that have become Hebrew scholars today now. And we're going to have our readers read from the TLV, Tree of Life, version of the... for the Torah portion in English today.
The first reading will be from Exodus, Shemot 21, verse 1. That's where I'll start right now. Now these are the ordinances which you will set before them. If you buy a Hebrew servant, he is to serve for 6 years, and in the seventh he is to go free without payment. If he comes in by himself, he is to go out by himself. If he was married, then his wife will go out with him. If his master gave him a wife, and she bears him sons or daughters, the wife and her children will be her master's, and he will go free by himself. But if the servant plainly states, I love my master and my wife and my children, I will not go out free. Then his master is to bring him to God, then take him to a door or to a doorpost. His master is to pierce his ear through with an awl, and he will serve him forever. Verse 7, if a man sells his daughter to be a maidservant, she is not to go free as male servants do. If she does not please her master, who has selected her for himself, then she is to allow her to be redeemed. He will have no power to sell her to a foreign people, seeing as he has dealt deceitfully toward her. If he betroths her to his son, he must give her the rights of a daughter. If he takes another wife, he is not to diminish her food, her clothing, or her marriage rights. If he does not provide these three to her, then she is to go free without payment.
Continuing in Exodus 23:1-9, do not spread false report. Do not join hands with the wicked by becoming malicious witness. Do not follow a crowd to do evil, nor are you to testify in a case to follow a crowd and pervert justice. On the other hand, nor should you take sides with a poor man in his case. If you find your enemy's ox or his donkey going astray, you must surely bring it back to him again. If you see the donkey of the one that hates you lying down under its burden, do not leave it. Rather, you are to release it with him. You are not to pervert justice to your poor in his dispute. Stay far away from a false charge. Do not kill the innocent and the righteous, for I will not justify the guilty. Take no bribe, for a bribe blends those who have sight and perverts the words of the righteous. Do not oppress an outsider, for you know the heart of an outsider, since you were outsiders in the land of Egypt.
Continuing in Exodus 23:10-19. For 6 years you are to sow your land and gather the increase, but during the seventh year you are to let it rest and lie fallow, so that the poor among your people may eat. Whatever they leave behind, the animals of the field may eat. You are to deal with your vineyard and your olive grove in the same way. You are to do your work for 6 days, but on the seventh day you will rest, so that your ox and your donkey may have rest, and also the son of your handmaid and the outsider may be refreshed. With all the things that I have said to you, take heed. Make no mention of the names of other gods, and do not let them be heard in your mouth. 3 times in the year you are to celebrate a festival for me. You are to observe the Feast of Matzot. For 7 days you will eat matzot, as I command you, at the time appointed in the month of Aviv. For that is when you came out of Egypt. No one is to appear before me empty-handed. Also you are to observe the Feast of Harvest, the first fruits of your labors that you sow in the field, as well as the Feast of the Ingathering and the end of the year, when you gather your crops from the field. 3 times in the year, all your men are to appear before Adonai Elohim. Do not offer the blood of my sacrifice with hametz, nor is the fat of my feast to remain out all night until the morning. Bring the choicest first fruits of your land into the house of Adonai your God. Do not boil a kid in its mother's milk.
By the way, the kid is a goat, not a real kid. We don't boil kids.
Continuing Exodus 24:1-8. Then Moses, he said, come up to Adonai, you and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and the 70 elders of Israel, and worship from afar. Moses alone is to approach Adonai, but the other may not draw near, nor are the people to go up with him. So Moses came and told the people all the words of Adonai, as well as all the ordinances. All the people answered with one voice and said, all the words which Adonai has spoken, we will do. So Moses wrote down all the words of Adonai, then rose up early in the morning and built an altar below the mountain, along with 12 pillars for the 12 tribes of Israel. He then sent out young men of B'nai Israel who sacrificed burnt offering and fellowship offering of oxen to Adonai. Then Moses took half of the blood and put it on basin, and the other half he poured out against the altar. He took the scroll of the covenant and read in the hearing of the people. Again they said, all that Adonai has spoken, we will do and obey. Then Moses took the blood, sprinkled it on the people, and said, behold, the blood of the covenant, which Adonai cut with you, in agreement with all these words.
Continuing with Exodus 24, 9 through 18. Then Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel went up. They saw the God of Israel, and under his feet was something like a pavement of sapphire, as clear as the very heavens. Yet he did not raise his hand against the nobles of B'nai Israel, so they beheld God, then ate and drank. Then Adonai said to Moses, come up to me on the mountain and stay there, and I will give you the tablets of stone with the Torah and the mitzvot, which I have written, so that you may instruct them. So Moses rose up, along with his attendant Joshua, and Moses went up unto the mountain of God. To the elders he said, wait for us here until we come back to you. See, Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute should go to them. When Moses went up on the mountain, the cloud covered it. The glory of Adonai settled upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. Then on the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the midst of the cloud. The appearance of the glory of Adonai was like a consuming fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of B'nai Israel. So Moses entered into the midst of the cloud and went up onto the mountain. Moses was on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. And that is the word of the Lord.
Amen. You know, I love the verse in Exodus 24, 7 in Hebrew, Kol asher diber Adonai na'aseh v'nishma. And literally it says that all that the Lord has said, we will hear first, but we will do and we will hear. And the Sadducees, it records in the commentary, thought that was impetuous. They thought that was just ridiculous. They thought that was crazy for people to say that they will do something before they hear what they have to do.
Right.
But the word hear, Shema, means to hear and obey. Right. So some translators would say that it means we will do and we will obey. It's kind of like enlisting in the army. You say yes and amen, in a sense, before you ever know what they're going to ask you to do. And when you're in battle, they're going to give direct commands. Mm-hmm. And you're going to have to obey that, even if it means taking out an enemy that you didn't think you were going to have to take out today, but you're going to have to do what they said. And that includes the boot camp. And you're thinking, why do I have to do this? No, you said yes, that we will do, and then we will hear. Meaning we will always keep our ear open to hear and obey, because we already said we will do.
Right.
And you know, it's kind of like a marriage. You say, I do, even before you know what your spouse is going to ask on the honey-do list. I always say a happy wife is a happy life. But in God's divine order, a happy groom, right? Makes more room. No, it's gonna keeps you from getting the broom. No, I don't know. You know, the funny thing about God is the husband at Sinai, and Israel is the bride. This is where we get the picture of what Solomon was saying in the Song of Solomon, or the Song of Songs, that he was in love with only one woman, even though he had 700 wives and 300 concubines. It's kind of like Messiah's love for us. Mm-hmm. So Solomon becomes a picture of Messiah, just like he was speaking the words on that would relate to what God was saying to Israel, that I love you, you're my beloved, I am my beloved is mine. Mm-hmm. And when we think of that picture, Messiah has said, I do, and I will obey, even if that means he struggles with a cup that speaks of his final death. Take this cup from me, mm-hmm. but not my will be done, your will be done, right? So Yeshua could say, Na sebe nishma, in the Garden of Gethsemane, because he was saying, I will do, and I will be obedient. If we could do that, we wouldn't struggle so much. We wouldn't wrestle so much. We wouldn't have sleepless nights. We could go to bed in shalom, in peace, and wake up with peace. Because we've said, Na'aseh v'nishma. Can you say those words? Na'aseh v'nishma. We will commit to do, but then we will hear the commands and be obedient to them. Amen? So let's close with the final blessing of this wonderful portion today. It speaks so much. Right after the 10 words, we have all these mishpatim, which show all of the rational rulings, many of the 613 that will be included in a rabbinical understanding as the Taryag, the Hebrew letters that have the numerical value of 610 and 3 of 613. So today we're going to say the blessing because of all of these words that were spoken, that we're literally saying yes to them, knowing that God gave them to us. Amen?
Amen.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natan lanu Torat emet, v'chayei olam atah betochenu, Baruch atah Adonai, noten ha-torah. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who gave us the Torah of truth and life everlasting. And in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Amen.
The Hagbah is the lifting of the Torah scroll, revealing three panels of the reading. We point to it as a witness, declaring this is the word of the Lord.
Bezot HaTorah asher sam Moshe lifnei b'nei Yisrael, api Adonai b'yam Moshe. And this is the Torah that Moses placed for the children of Israel at the command of the Lord by the hand of Moses. Amen.
We place back on the Torah the belt of truth as we wear as spiritual armor, the belt of truth. We also have a breastplate to put on through the mantle, covers it, just like we're clothed with the garments of praise, and we put on a breastplate of righteousness, the way the priest wore a breastplate in the presence of God in the holy place, the high priest did. And the Torah is going to go back into the Ark of Safety, the Aron HaKodesh. It's like a ketubah, a marriage covenant between God and Israel, and between us and Messiah. Amen? Today it's no longer just written on stone tablets or on a scroll, it's written on our hearts by the Spirit of God. Amen. So today, from the words of the book of Proverbs, let's call it our Etz Hayim, the tree of life. And as a picture of Yeshua being lifted up, we're going to lift it up knowing that he became our tree of life because he died on a tree to give us life. Amen.
Amen.
Etz Hayim hi lamachazik imach betoheha
It is a tree of life for those who take hold of it, and those who support it are praiseworthy. Its rays are rays of pleasantness, and all of us pass with peace. Bring us back, O Lord, to you, and we shall come. Renew our days as of old. Amen.
This time we'll hear from the prophet reading known as the Haftarah. We'll say the blessing as we prepare our hearts for the book of BenYa'akov, for the portion that relates to Mishpatim, Jeremiah 34, 8 through 22, and also 33, 25 through 26 is a closing thought.
Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam Asher bachar b'din tovim v'ratzah b'divrehem hanemarim v'emet Baruch ata Adonai Habocher b'Torah u'b'Moshe abdo u'Yisrael amo u'b'nviei ha'emet b'tzedek. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has chosen good prophets and was pleased with their words that were uttered with truth. Blessed are you, O Lord, who chooses the Torah, Moses' his servant, Israel his nation, and the prophets of truth and righteousness. Amen.
All right. And our Jeremiah passage starts with chapter 34, verse 8. Our scroll Chumash version reads this way. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord after King Zedekiah sealed a covenant with the entire people that was in Jerusalem to proclaim freedom for them, that every man set free his bondsman and his bondswoman, the Jew and the Jewess, that no man should enslave his fellow Jew, all of the leaders and the entire people who entered into the covenant hearkened, and every man should set free his bondsman and every man his bondswoman, not to enslave them further. They hearkened and they sent them off. And after that, they reversed themselves and brought back the bondsmen and the bondswomen, whom they had set free, and subjugated them as slaves and maidservants. Wow, they just broke the Torah. And then the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, so says the Lord God of Israel, I sealed a covenant with your forefathers on the day that I took them out of the land of Egypt from the house of slaves, saying, at the end of 7 years, each of you shall set free his Jewish brother who will be sold to you. He shall serve you for 6 years, and then you shall set him free from yourself. But your fathers did not hearken to me, nor did they incline their ear. An ear nailed to the door. Today you repented and did what is right in my eyes, for every man to proclaim freedom for his fellow, and you sealed a covenant before me in the temple upon which my name is called. Then you reversed yourself and desecrated my name, and every man brought back his bondsman and every man his bondswoman, whom you set free on their own, and you subjugated them to be slaves and maidservants to you. Therefore, says the Lord, you did not hearken to me to proclaim freedom every man for his brother and every man for his fellow. Behold, I proclaim you to be free, the words of the Lord, for the sword, for the plague, for the famine, and I will make you an object of trepidation for all the kingdoms of the earth. I shall give the people who violated my covenant, those who did not uphold the words of the covenant they sealed before me, the calf that they cut into two and passed between its parts. That's a covenant ceremony. The leaders of Judah and the leaders of Jerusalem, the officers of the Kohanim, the priests, and all the people of the land who passed through the parts of the calf, while everybody walked the parts, I will give them into the hand of the enemies and into the hand of those who seek their lives. Their corpse will be carrion for the bird of heaven and the beast of the field. And King Zedekiah, king of Judah, and his leaders I shall give into the hand of their enemies and into the hand of those who seek their lives, and into the hand of the army of the king of Babylon, who have advanced away from me. Behold, I have commanded the word of the Lord, and I will return them to this city, and they shall wage war against it, conquer it, and burn it in fire. I will make the cities of Judah desolate, without an inhabitant. Chapter 33, we go back to verse 25. So says the Lord, were it not for my covenant day and night, were it not for my covenant day and night, had I not established the laws of heaven and earth, then I might abominate the offspring of Jacob and David, not to take its offspring as rulers over the offspring of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. For I shall bring back their captivity and show them mercy. Now I found it very interesting that the rabbis put together a reading from chapter 34 that related to the Torah portion about the slave being released in 6 years. But they felt that they should go back a chapter to 25 and 26 of chapter 33 because they wanted to make sure we remember that in context, God had already said that I will not completely destroy Israel even if I allow them to go into exile.
I'm going to bring them out. And that's exactly what God did, so that we're not left with this discouraging word of, well, they're going into Babylon. No, they're going to come out of Babylon. And Jeremiah prophesied 70 years. And that's exactly how many years from 516 B.C. to, from, excuse me, 586 B.C. to 516 16 B.C., there was exactly 70 years that they were in captivity until the temple was rebuilt in Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. What a beautiful picture. I'm waiting for the temple to be rebuilt again. Yeah. It will show that God is bringing all the Jewish people out of the exile of the nations, the Galut, and bringing them home to their promised land, because God says, because of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, I will do this. The sure mercies of David, I will do this. There will always be a son to sit upon your throne. There will always be a people of Abraham's seed that will be in the land of Israel, even if it's a remnant. And God will save Israel. That in the last days, all of Israel will be saved. Amen. I believe that all of Israel will see him that was pierced for them, and they will turn. If they haven't already turned before he appears as a sign in the heavens, guess what? They will cry out to him and say, save me. They will cry out the words, Yeshua, sin Yeshua, sin Yeshua. Yeshua is salvation. Guess who's going to show up? Yeshua.
Yeah.
And they will be able to see the one they cried out for. Amen?
Amen.
So let's say the closing blessing today for the prophet reading. And thank the Lord that God's promise is sure to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob. His promises through Moses and his promise to David and Solomon. God kept his promise in Messiah.
Amen.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu, melech ha'olam, sur kol ha'amim, tzadik b'chol ha'arot, ha'el ha'neiman, ha'omer ve'oseh, ha'mdaber u'mkayem, shechol devarav, emet v'asedek. Ne'aman atahu Adonai Eloheinu, v'nemerim devarecha, v'devar echad midvarecha, achor lo yushirekam, ki o'melech ne'aman barakaman atah, Baruch atah Adonai, ha'el ha'neiman, b'chol devarav. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, Rock of all eternities, righteous in all generations, the trustworthy God, who says and does, who speaks and fulfills, all of whose words are true and righteous. Trustworthy are you, O Lord our God, and trustworthy are your words. Not one of your words is turned back to its origin unfulfilled. For you are God, trustworthy and compassionate King. Blessed are you, O Lord, the God who is trustworthy in all his words. Amen. Have mercy on Zion, for it's the source of our life, to the one who is deeply humbled to bring salvation speedily in our days. Blessed are you, O Lord, who glad Zion through her children. Amen. Gladness, O Lord our God, with Elijah the prophet, your servant, and with the kingdom of the house of David, your anointed Messiah. May he come speedily and cause our heart to exult. On his throne let no stranger sit, nor let others continue to inherit his honor. For by your holy name you swore to him that his lamp will not be extinguished forever and ever. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord, shield of David, Magen David. Amen. Al HaTorah, Al HaVodah, Al HaNevi'im, Al Yom HaShabbat HaZeh, Shenatatan lanu Adonai Eloheinu, Likdusha v'limnucha, Lechavod v'letifaret. Al hakol Adonai Eloheinu, Anachnu modim lach, Urachim otach, Yitbarak shemcha b'fi kohai, Temi le'olam v'en, Baruch atah Adonai, Mekadesh ha-Shabbat. Amen. For the Torah reading, for the prayer service, for the reading from the prophets, and for this Sabbath day that you, O Lord our God, have given us, for holiness and contentment, for glory and splendor. For all this, O Lord our God, we gratefully thank you and bless you. May your name be blessed by the mouth of all the living always, for all eternity. Blessed are you, O Lord, who sanctifies the Sabbath. Amen. I'm getting a little emotional up here because these young kids sang the blessing today. I'm just, all I can think of is my daughter one day having her bat mitzvah and leading the congregation when she comes of age. And I just think about how we should raise up that next generation the way Moses rose up Joshua to take in those younger ones from birth to 19 that grew up 40 years later to become men and women of the congregation. How many know, we always say that they're like the congregation of tomorrow, but really they're today's leaders that are teaching us that a little babe shall lead them.
Amen.
And out of the mouth of babes comes pure praise, and he ordains strength. So guess what? I'm being strengthened just by hearing these younger voices say these blessings and continue on and forge through to the next generation. And I'm just looking forward to the next day that we have like a thriving youth and children's ministry, to where we just have kids running around this place like crazy. In fact, it might not be this place. It might be a whole other place that we're in, because we're just beaming and growing and expanding. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. If we could just get strong in the Lord and the power of his might, I believe God could do it if we were all just raise up that leadership inside of us and be that leader that God's called us to be. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Let's have the reader of the Brit Hadashah come at this time.
Amen.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher natzavanu Mashiach Yeshua v'adevarim Baruch atah Adonai notein ha'brit hadashah Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us Messiah Yeshua and the words of the new covenant. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the new covenant. Amen.
This morning we're reading from Matthew 5, 31 through 42. It was said, whoever sends his wife away, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that everyone who divorces his wife, except for sexual immorality, makes her commit adultery, and whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not swear falsely, but shall carry out your oath to God, to Adonai. But I tell you, do not swear at all, not by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by earth, for it is the footstool of his feet, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make a single hair white or black, but let your word yes be yes, and your no, no. Anything more than this is from the evil one. You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evildoer. But whoever slaps you on your right cheek, turn to him also the other. And the one wanting to sue you and to take your shirt, let him also have your coat. Whoever forces you to go 1 mile, go with him too. Give to the one who asks of you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. This is the word of the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, last week's portion we read, I believe it was 15 through 30, and Yeshua gave us the instruction that, or the clarification that, do not think I came to destroy the law or the prophets, I came to fulfill. But he also taught us to fulfill them by not breaking even one of the least of these commandments and teaching somebody else to break them, but to do them first and then teach them.
Right.
And I thought about that, na'aseh v'nishma, that we do and then we hear. Mm-hmm. So as a teacher, I teach what I hear, but I also hear what I've committed to do.
Right.
And so until you do it, you really can't teach it with effectiveness.
Right. Yeah.
Because it's easy for you, if you lay carpet, to teach someone else how to lay carpet. But if you only watch a video online, and you're going to say, oh, I watched this video, let me show you how to lay carpet,
right.
And then you run into a problem and a little snag in the rug, you know, and all of a sudden you wonder, like, well, that wasn't in the video. They didn't show that part of what to do there. Well, that's because it's not practical, because you haven't done it yourself.
Right.
And until you actually work on perfecting it yourself, it's easy. If you know how to perfect the baking of a cake from scratch, you can show by someone else how to bake a cake from scratch and even do it gluten-free. But if you've never made a gluten-free cake, you're going to go box style. And for so long, we've boxed in our faith. We have box faith. We've put God in a box. And we've not allowed God to be who he is in the scripture from cover to cover, from Genesis to Revelation. No more replacement theology. No more taking away the commandments and destroying them. Instead, doing what Yeshua did. He said, you've heard them say this. Now let me expand the understanding of that verse a little bit. And every one of the commands, he didn't abrogate. He didn't say, get rid of thou shalt not commit adultery. He says, let's go deeper than that. Let's talk about the root of why people commit adultery. Let's go deeper than just, you know, we make a formal covenant. That's great. But people in the days of Yeshua were using what was a formal covenant into a quick, Well, I swear by heaven I'll do it. It wasn't even going through the parts. Remember what Jeremiah said. You guys did the formal covenant. You all went through the parts, and you still broke it. How more flippantly can we just say, oh, yeah, I'll do it. I swear by heaven I'm going to do it, and we don't even do it. And we've not even walked through the parts of the sacrificial animal, through the blood, like a formal ceremony. How much more people watering it down even more, just saying, oh, I told you I was going to do it. I swore by God that I would do it. And then you put God's name on something that you didn't fulfill. So you want God to back up your words when you won't back up his.
Right.
And that's where God through Messiah was telling us, let's go back to the original purpose of Torah, not to condemn anyone, not to put anyone down, but to make us more circumspect on why we do what we do. Because we said, Naaseh v'nishma. We will say yes, that we will do it, even before we hear. And as we hear, we will understand how to do it even better. Because when you first do something, you do it okay the first time. And then you said, next time I'm going to do it even better. How many have done that before? Whether it's cooking, baking, cutting your lawn, a job. If you messed up on a job, you tell yourself, oh, I never want to do that again. You know, maybe you almost lost your job. You're thinking, right, by the grace of God, I didn't lose my job. Well, shouldn't that propel us to want to do more? So instead of saying, well, I can't keep this old book, I'm going to throw it out. How about we say, hey, Lord, I messed up, but I come back to you. I return back to your Torah, and I want you to show me how to do it better this time. I didn't do it right the last time, but I'm going to do it better this time around. Amen. So Holy Spirit, you lead me and guide me into all truth and what the original purpose was for why you gave that commandment. And if I'm coming short of it, you help me fill in the gap and show me how to do it through the motivation of love. Amen. Loving God, loving my neighbors, myself. I won't commit adultery. I won't steal. I won't do that. Not because we just said it with lip service.
Right.
But we said it with heart, intention, and understanding of, wow, now I know the safeguards, the fences that will keep me from even getting close to committing adultery. It's not even lusting, it's the not lusting after the woman. Because you know what Job said? I love this. He says, Karti, he says, Brit Karti, Le'enai. I make a covenant with my eyes. I'm literally cutting covenant with my eyes, meaning my eyes are not going to lust after a woman. Because he says, why should I lust? Or in the Hebrew, why should I be meditating about a woman? Because that's what David did. It's so funny. Maybe if Job and David could have got together somehow in time or in teaching, David could have said that before he lusted after Bathsheba. But look, what God turned for evil for the good. Out of that second child came Solomon. And God redeemed. And then when Solomon messed up, then God redeemed. And each time man messed up, if they would come back to God, God would redeem it. Aren't you glad for a God who not only gives you instructions, but when you break them, he still redeems, he still forgives, he still gives you grace, but not to mess up again, to try even with more zeal to say, this time I'm going to do it better than last time because I'm getting closer to the goal of being that spotless bride, being that corporate bride of believers that God is looking for and who Messiah is coming for. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So let's say the closing blessing today for the Brit Hadashah. And may when we read the covenant of the that's older versus the covenants that are newer, and we see that one covenant is built upon another, we try not to take one covenant, like the new covenant, and destroy or annul the other, because it's impossible to do. You can't take any of God's words and destroy it. Right. Don't add, don't take away. Amen?
Amen.
Let's say the blessing. Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Natan Lanu Divrei Emet V'Chayei Olam Ata V'Tochenu Baruch Ata Adonai Notein Abrit HaChadashah Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who gave us the words of truth and life everlasting, planted in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the new covenant. Amen. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a hand clap for praise. Shabbat shalom, everyone.
Shalom.
Good to be in the house of the Lord today. Are you happy to be here today?
Yes.
Baruch Hashem, and Boker Tov to all of you this morning. And we're going to get right into the Word of God today. And it's a week before the NJAA Southwest Regional Conference, so I will not be here next week, but you're going to hear a great word from Rabbi Eric, and I know he's excited about the Sanctuary of the Heart we'll be talking about. So we are going to be looking at a message today called Possessing All the Promises of God. And this is coming from Parashat Mishpatim. How many read their 6 days of manna this week?
Yes.
Either on Facebook you got it, or if you emailed me, hopefully I got it to you, and we're able to study together as a congregation. So we want to say a hearty welcome to our first-time guests that are here. And
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Rosalind's happy.
Next, can you reconnect?
Amen.
Oh, it could be a dead battery. Oh, there you go. All right, can you say a hearty Bruhim Halaim to all of our first-time guests today and say welcome? Or if you're a returning family member today, we've got quite a few kids today, so great to have children in the house of the Lord, like a Joshua generation. Shabbat Shalom to everyone. And we're looking at this portion of Mishpatim, which comes from Shemot, or Exodus 21:1 through 24:18. We heard Yirmiyahu, or the book of Jeremiah, 34:8 through 22, and also as a consolation, chapter 33, 25 through 26. The book of Matityahu for the Brit Hadashah, the New Covenant, Matthew 5, 31 through 42, we read today. So we're going to get into our 10 minutes of Torah. You excited today?
Yes.
Yeah. You don't sound too excited. You excited today?
Yeah.
This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad. Amen. We're looking at Exodus 21:1, and it says in the TLV, or Tree of Life version, which by the way is now on Bible Gateway, as it's always been on the New Version app, and so you can also check out the Bible Gateway and see the Tree of Life is on there. That's a huge accomplishment. That means it's free of charge.
Yeah.
Anybody else excited out there?
Yes.
Some of you have made the purchase of getting the Bible, and now it's available online, free for people all over the world to be able to read this new Messianic version. So we're grateful for that. Bereshit, or, oh, it should be actually Shemot. I apologize for that. That's a typo there. Shemot, or Exodus 21:1, says, "Now these are the ordinances which you have set before them. If you buy a Hebrew servant, he is to serve for 6 years, and on the seventh he is to go free without payment. If he comes in by himself, he should go out by himself. If he was married, then his wife will go out with him." And again, I'm sorry for this typo of the Parashat, it should be Shemot. Exodus 21:4 says, "If his master gave him a wife, she bears him sons and daughters, and the wife and her children will be her master's, and he will go free by himself. But if the servant plainly states, 'I love my master and my wife and my children, and I will not go free,' then his master is to bring him to God, then take him to a door or to a doorpost, the mezuzah, and then it says his master is to pierce his ear through with an awl, and he shall serve him forever." What an interesting ceremony that is, to say he wanted to be connected to the house. So there was this piercing of the ear. Who knows, that could have been one of the ancient customs of the day, to pierce an ear showing belonging to some tribe or group, or even sometimes occultic practices piercing could be connected to, because tattooing and piercing could have been connecting you to the deity that you worshipped. But God would sometimes take things and redeem them, and so this piercing of the ear was not only for beautifying sometimes among women to have wear earrings, but in those days even men sometimes had nose rings, earrings. You'd just be amazed. King David had quite a bit, and it said that all the Israelites, you know, they had tons of these earrings and nose rings and things of that nature. So let's not look down on someone if they have a nose ring or an earring when we think it's not appropriate, because in the biblical days they did have those. And they were just forms of adornment. In this case, this was a ceremony to show that you were connected to the house. Say connected.
Connected.
It's funny, the vav is a nail that connects two things in Hebrew, and it means to connect two concepts, like boys and girls, men and women. You use the vav to connect the two. In this case, the hook. How many know that the hook, or the nail of Messiah, connects us to him? It not only nails our sins to his cross, but it also connects us eternally to the Father through Messiah. So it's interesting when you talk about being pierced, Yeshua was pierced for us, wasn't he?
Yes.
So you can see a picture of that. What's interesting about that is not only is he the pierced one, but he's the door.
Mm-hmm.
He's the door of the sheepfold. So being connected to the house is seen in this ceremony of the servant who should be released after 6 years, who wants to stay a member of the household. His whole family has been developed there. He wants to stay a part of the house, and he stays connected through this ceremony of having his ear pierced, but the ceremony is done to the door. Obviously, they then release him from the door, but the key was that was the way they pierced his ear. And it's interesting that the piercing was done on the door, or the mezuzah, the door frame, because that's where the blood was applied that freed all of Israel. And it also was the place where the mezuzah formerly known as we call it a mezuzah today. The mezuzah is the door frame, but it's also the name of the little case that we hold Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 9, the Shema in. And we put it, it says right on the doorpost of your house. Instead of literally writing on a doorpost, we write it on a scroll that gets put into the doorpost in a little container called the doorpost or the mezuzah. So there's a ceremony here that connects to the freeing of Israel from Egypt. And the blood, how interesting. You'd pierce the ear and who knows if there'd be a little bloodshed there. I just kind of think about that, you know. And I remember my daughter crying the first time she got her ears pierced. It was like, ah! After that, she was fine. Took a little while for that ear to be able to handle earrings without some kind of infection or anything like that. We'd have to put stuff on it. And I remember all the process. I can imagine that this was a way for the servant to always remember, you chose to be pierced to the door of the house. Yeah. You chose to follow your master. You chose. And that's like you and I. We choose to do that. Amen?
Yeah.
We choose to follow him. We choose to have this ceremony of saying, I want my ear to the door. Mm-hmm. The rabbis say it's interesting that Shema means to hear with the ear, but also to hear and obey. So the servant is saying, even though I'm free, I'm going to hear and obey by piercing my ear to the door. How many of us have our ear to Yeshua?
Yes.
And are hearing what he's telling us to hear? He said, he that hath an ear to hear, let him hear what this spirit is saying. Now, let's go beyond this concept of servants being connected to the house. And let's go into a little deeper thought. Again, it should be Shemot. Exodus 23, 27 says, I will send my terror before you and throw all the people to whom you come into, all the people whom you will come into panic and make all your enemies turn their back to you. So it's interesting when you think of this concept of Israel going into possess the land. God says, I'm going to send terror before you and throw all the people to whom you will come into panic. So when you come, the enemy is afraid.
Mm-hmm.
What are we afraid of then? We shouldn't be afraid. He should be afraid.
Amen.
Our adversary should be afraid when we show up. Because we're coming in the name of the Lord. And when we come in the name of the Lord, like David killing Goliath, our enemy is defeated.
Amen.
So we should never be afraid to come into a situation where the enemy is trying to threaten us and tell us, you better back off, you better go backwards, you better go back to Egypt where you belong. No, I belong in the promised land.
Amen.
I don't belong in the past. I belong in the future that God has for me.
Amen.
And that's what I'm pressing towards. So in verse 29, it says, I will drive them out, it says, before you in a single year. Otherwise, the land would become desolate and the animals of the field will multiply against you. But little by little, I will drive them out from before you until you are fruitful. Then you will possess the land. How many realize that the Lord is driving the enemy out little by little out of your life?
Amen.
So, line upon line, precept upon precept, faith to faith, strength to strength, glory to glory. He's trying to push the enemy back. He's trying to get you to take one step at a time, one line of scripture at a time, one precept at a time, and begin to build a walk of faith that knows that when you come into a situation, the enemy is actually more afraid of you than you should be of him.
Amen.
You're pushing the enemy back one day at a time, one a moment at a time. Little by little, I will drive them out. Little by little. Poco a poco, right? And so we say, little by little, I will drive them out from before you until you are fruitful. Then you will what? You will what? I can't hear you. You will what?
Possess.
You will possess the land. What land does God want you to possess this year? Ultimately, God wants us in the promised land of Israel and Jerusalem. We'll all be there one day. Maybe it'll take the Jerusalem to become new again, for us to be in the new Jerusalem. Until then, we can plan trips to travel there. But beyond the actual land that God was speaking concerning Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob's inheritance, I want you to think about what God wants you to possess this year. What promise has God given you that you're supposed to possess? But there is another problem in your way. There's a giant that's trying to scare you and push you back. And God's saying to you, you should know that he's more afraid of you than you are of him. He's more afraid of you. So whatever fear you have, forget about it, because God is the bigger G out of the G's. You're not a little grasshopper, and he's not a big giant. But your God is a big God.
Amen.
And to God, the giants are small.
Right. Really small.
Just like the problems are really small.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead, you can say an amen on that one. That's some good stuff right there. Now, last thought I have from the Torah portion, from the Torah today, is from Vayikra, Leviticus 20, verse 24. It says, "But I have said to you, you will inherit their land, and I will give it to you to what?
Possess it.
A land flowing with what?
Milk
and honey. I am Adonai your God who has set you apart from the peoples." So I set you apart, and I'm giving you their land. What that means is, they're unholy, you are holy. Therefore, it's my holy land, and I can choose to give it to a holy people. So you're going to be my holy nation, my peculiar people. You're going to be a chosen generation. You are going to be kings and priests in that land. And you're going to do what they couldn't do.
Yeah.
They couldn't live holy. They couldn't represent me and be my king and my priest. They wouldn't be chosen. All nations heard the Torah at Sinai, and they heard the 10 words.
Yeah.
But only Israel said, "Naaseh v'nishma."
Mm.
I will do, and I will continue to obey what I hear.
Mm-hmm.
This is what we need to do as a people. We need to be set apart by saying, "Naaseh v'nishma." We need to possess the land that God is putting ahead of us.
Amen.
I even believe for Simchat Yeshua, there's some land that God wants to bless us with.
Amen.
I don't know. I'm praying for some of you to get like $1 million.
Yeah.
No, I'm not kidding. Because I'm thinking of that tithe you're going to give to buy our parcel of land. No, I'm not joking. This community has not seen a messianic congregation like they're going to see.
Amen.
That means we've got to get strong in the Lord and in the power of His might and believe that God wants to raise us up for such a time as this. And though we've been secluded in obscurity and in the darkness in the back in the booth in the corner of the dark, we've been like David in the field keeping sheep, you know, and nobody knows about us, and the prophet has to ask about us, where's that other brother at, where's that other son at, you know, of Jesse. But guess what? God's saying, "I'm about to take you out of the field, and I'm about to bring you into big places."
Yeah.
Now, it's not about buildings, it's not about money, it's not about wealth, it's about possessing what God said, "I want you to have."
Yes.
It's not about you lusting after it, it's about saying, "It's your time." Now, I've always been the kind of person, I said, "No, not me, Lord, not me." I was like Moses, "No, not me." I remember my first time being asked to speak or preach in a church, in a youth group. And I said I would, and it was a 5-minute sermonette on one of the parables of the Messiah. And I said, "Oh, okay, I'll do it." But then the whole time I was doubting myself whether I could do it. And my knees were knocking with the idea. And finally, me and my friend were supposed to tag team it. And he said he didn't want to do it. So I said, "Well, if he's not going to do it, I'm not going to do it." How funny, about a year later, I became the youth pastor of the whole youth group. Because even though I said no, God said yes.
Yeah.
And you need to know that sometimes you're saying no to God when you see you say no to the giant.
Yeah.
And saying yes to God, because God's bigger than the giant.
Yeah.
And we need to say Naaseh v'nishma. Now let's take a look at the prophet, prophetic precepts of the Haftarah. And I want to actually take you to Joshua, because I think it relates to this idea of possessing the land. Because with Joshua, that's where they actually go ahead and possess the land of promise. So as we take a look at 10 minutes of the Haftarah, let's take a look at Joshua 5:1. Now it says, "And it came about when all the Amorite kings beyond the Jordan westward and all the Canaanite kings by the sea heard how Adonai had dried up the waters of the what?
Jordan.
And how, or before B'nai Israel, which means the sons of Israel, the children of Israel, until they had crossed, their heart melted, nor was there any spirit in them anymore. Literally, they lost their breath, they lost their heart, they lost their drive, they lost all their fierceness. There was no spirit in them anymore. They're about almost a dead man. Because of B'nai Israel. Remember, God said in the Torah, "I'm going to put fear in them." He literally, in the verses that I didn't read, says, "I'm going to send a hornet to drive them crazy." Can you imagine if, like, literally a bug, you know, comes buzzing your way and that drives you out of battle?
Yes.
Why do you let things bug you so much?
Yeah.
The enemy's trying to send a bug, a pestilence, an irritant your way to drive you out of the battlefield. But if you'll stand your ground and be still and know that He is God, God will bug your enemy and bug him right out of battle.
Yes.
I'm praying that your problems become plagued by God's provision for you.
Amen.
That they're fearful of what they might think they could even do to you because they're touching God by touching you.
Yes.
The apple of His eye.
Amen.
That's my prayer. Now, look what it says. I love this in verse 2. At that time, Adonai said to Joshua, make yourself flint knives and circumcise again, B'nai Israel, a second time. Wow. What's this all about? Not too fun, right? Verse number 3. So Joshua made flint knives and circumcised B'nai Israel. That's a lot of people. That's a long day of circumcision. That's before, you talk about hospitals being packed. This took day and night, I'm sure. It says, circumcise all B'nai Israel at Gibeat Ha'arolot. And it says here, now this is the reason why Joshua was circumcised. All the people that came out of Egypt were who? Males, all the men of war, had died in the wilderness along the way after they came out of Egypt, except for who? Obviously Joshua, and who else?
Caleb.
Now verse 5 says, though all the people that came out were circumcised, all of them. Remember, you couldn't even eat the lamb unless you were circumcised. A Gentile that was eating with you that night could eat the matzah. He could drink the wine. He could partake of the meal, except he couldn't have the meat. It's like saying you can't have the main course, because the main course is for Israel. Why? They cried for deliverance, and I gave them a lamb. Therefore, it's for them. If you want to be included in, you can, but you have to realize this is a covenant meal. And the only way to be a part of this is to be a part of the covenant. So if they wanted to actually eat and partake of the lamb, not just be under the blood's protection, but partake of the lamb, they had to cut covenant. That means they had to be circumcised. That was not obligatory. It was voluntary. You could choose to do that. You could have just ate the matzah, been okay with that, and, you know, enjoyed the appetizer. But the main dish was for Israel. So God said, the only way to know that these Egyptians are really with you, because they could turn against you. They could be there stealthily with you, working for Pharaoh. Just imagine the mentality. And in fact, just so you know you can trust them, because before you couldn't trust them. So just so you know you can trust the Egyptians that are with you on that Passover evening, if they get circumcised, they're proving that they really want this.
Amen.
Okay? So we see this circumcision is not for those who were circumcised, but those of the younger generation that had never been circumcised in the wilderness of wandering. So here we see it says, verse 5, though all the people that came out were circumcised, none of the people that were born in the wilderness along the way as they came out of Egypt had been what? Had been circumcised. Look at verse 6. For B'nai Israel walked 40 years in the wilderness until all the nation's men of the war who came out of Egypt died out because they had not listened to the voice of Adonai. To them, Adonai had sworn that he would never let them see the land which God or Adonai had sworn to their fathers that he would give us, a land flowing with milk and honey. What did Leviticus 20:24 say? It was a land flowing with what? Milk and honey. Now, we understand that God promised here, as he did before, I will not let them enter the land. I swore, he says. God, in other words, God literally cut a covenant, not only to get Israel out of Egypt, but then he cut a covenant to keep the doubters in the desert. God has cut a covenant to keep the doubters in the desert to never enter the promised land. And how many know if you doubt the promise, you can't receive the promise?
Right.
So you're choosing your own destiny by doubting.
Yeah.
Because you're detouring your destiny instead of entering the land of promise. You can't blame God. You blame yourself for doubting him. In fact, worse than doubt, you gossip about his leaders, that are trying to lead you, and you talk about the people that are trying to train you. So how can you learn anything if you're talking against your teacher?
No.
It's funny, I always question that whenever I teach Bible college, and I have students that will sit around and say, why do we have to memorize these verses, and why do we have to read all this material, and why do we have to do that? Why come against the very reason you paid money to show up for class and get an education, and you're going to question the process? There's a method to the madness of the teacher, right? And he's trying to get you out of Egypt, through the wilderness, into the promised land. But if you can't follow the process and the procedure, you'll never make it to the promise. I know that's a lot of peas to handle this early in the morning, but it's really true. There is a process to your purpose. And until you're willing to be processed, even cheese sometimes has to be processed. It's not as good as the real cheese, but I mean, you know. But there is a process. You know, mozzarella, there's like a whole squeeze. You ever seen people make mozzarella cheese? It's like pulling and stretching and kneading and all this stuff to get you in the store this nice mozzarella cheese. Sometimes they even grate it for you in advance so you can make your pizza. In fact, if you're too lazy to do that, you can buy the pizza already made. Ready to go in the oven. And if you're still too lazy, you can go to the place and let them cook it for you too. But what if you can make it from scratch? And know what's going in? God says, I want you to do this from scratch. I don't want you to carry anything from Egypt over into your promised land. I want you to start over from scratch and leave the sins of the past behind. And let me give you the ingredients of what it's going to take to make the bread that you're needing that will last. Because man does not live by bread alone, but by every word, every instruction that comes from the mouth of God. And if you follow my instructions, I'll get you to the promised land. And when you get to the promised land, you won't need man anymore. You're going to eat the fat of the land. The land flowing already with milk and honey. Now, stop for a second. I pondered this week. When they went into the promised land, the 10 spies, what did they see? Big what?
Giants.
Oh, okay, you went there. Yeah, they saw big giants. I was actually thinking about the big fruits.
Right.
Do you know to your enemy, the fruits are not big, they're normal?
Right.
To giants, giant pomegranates are normal.
Right.
To us with small minds, small pomegranates are what we're used to. And in the wilderness, we have small thinking. That's why we complain about stuff that's too big for us. Because we can't see ourselves big enough to handle it because we see ourselves like grasshoppers when we see everybody else like giants. Have you ever think about people that are in the faith that are giants in the faith? Oh, I can never be like so-and-so. And you might name your favorite preacher, teacher, evangelist, or pastor, or someone with the gift of God in their life. And you say, but they're a giant in the faith. And you tell yourself you can't be that. Why can't you? If you were to have heard their story, they would tell you they probably were illiterate before they read the Bible. I know someone who was a preacher that was illiterate before he opened up the Bible and God taught him how to read from reading the Bible. But prior to that, he didn't know how to read. So what you call a giant is someone who started off thinking like they were a grasshopper.
Right.
What if you could imagine that the fruit's not so big because God, actually the fruit's kind of small.
Right.
What it means is what God has ahead of you, you're not familiar with.
Right.
It's like living on Taco Bell when God wants to invite you to Ruth Chris.
Right.
The mentality is I don't belong there. Can you imagine the Israelites said, I saw the land, it looks great, but I don't belong there. You might tell yourself the house is too expensive, the car, it's going to take too much gas. The job's going to require too much out of you. The marriage is going to mean you've got to stop living single and start thinking like a one. But whatever it is you think is too big for you, God says, I'm taking you there anyway.
Yeah.
So you might as well change the way you think about it and start embracing it, knowing it, and loving it. Because I want you to live and possess that land. And until you embrace the promise, you can't possess the possession of it.
True.
Because you have to dispossess your enemy before you can possess the land that belongs to you.
Yeah.
Stop telling yourself that job is not for you. Stop telling yourself that marriage is not for you. Stop telling yourself that property is not for you. It is for you. If God promised it, what he spoke, he'll do it. What he's promised, he's going to bring it to pass.
Amen.
You've got to trust him.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
Now, let's take a look at verse number 7. It says, but he raised up their children in their place. Joshua circumcised them, for they were uncircumcised, since they had not been circumcised along the way. Do you remember the nailing of the servant to the door? The purpose was to connect him to the house. In the way Eliezer was nailed to the door of his master, Abraham. Therefore, he could act like a son instead of a servant. And if Abraham wouldn't have had Isaac, then who would have received the inheritance? Eliezer, the servant. When you're in the kingdom of God, servants are treated like sons. Because sons are expected to serve as servants voluntarily. You got to nail your ear to the door of the house. Not to the ear of gossip, not to the ear of doubt or disbelief, not to the hearing of negative words, but you got to nail your ear to the door of the house. If God has planted you in Simchat Yeshua, nail your ear to the door. In fact, let us do it. We'll do a good job.
Yeah.
We'll even put some earrings in afterwards. No, I'm just kidding. What I mean by that is be committed.
Right.
Make a commitment that what we saw today with all these children, let's have it every Shabbat.
Amen.
Let's imagine possessing a land of promise for our young people, where young people are packing it out on a Friday night, and they just are gleaning from the youth leaders that are just pouring into them because they're hungry to possess the land that we've been talking about that God wants
Amen.
For us.
Amen.
See, if we talk about it, they'll want it. If we don't talk about it, they won't want it. And if we talk negatively of it, they'll think they can't have it. We have to tell this generation they can have the promises of God. Look at verse number 11. On the day after what day?
Passover.
On that very day they ate the produce of the what? Land. Matzot, which is the matzah. And roasted grain. Then the manna ceased. On the day after they had eaten of the produce of the land, B'nai Israel made manna no longer, but ate some of the yield of the land of Canaan that year. So in other words, you're not going to live on miracles anymore. You're going to live by principle. Because now you've got to sow seed in good ground and grow a harvest. Before, you could just believe God for a miracle, and God has to always fix our problems by a miracle. Oh, we don't have any water. Okay, water out of a rock. Oh, we have no bread. Okay, bread from heaven. Oh, we have no meat. Okay, quail from heaven. That is like El Pollo Loco gone crazy. They had to say stop. It was a 30-day quail storm.
Right.
Think about that. Stop! People bring you free chicken, you're going to say stop? No. But it's because they complained about it, and they were complaining about stuff they really didn't want.
Right.
Well, why don't we have this and why don't we have that? And then when you get it, you don't appreciate it.
Yeah.
Oh, man, that's a sermon by itself. Maybe that's next time. Let's keep going. Now, let's watch this. Now they're living by what they've sown in the land. Are you willing to sow into your promise? Mm-hmm. I'm not talking about money. I'm not about to take an offering. Are you willing to sow into your promise? That means whatever problem you have right now, go to the Word of God and find the promise in the Word of God. What does God say about your sickness? What does God say about your lack of money? What does God say about your lack of faith? What does God say about your lack of rest? God wants you to have peace, not just on Shabbat, but every day. In fact, Shabbat is supposed to be an overflowing rejuvenation of rest that flows into the rest of your week so you're not tired all the time.
Amen.
How many have been tired lately?
Yeah.
Maybe we're not getting out of Shabbat what we're supposed to.
Right.
We're supposed to get so filled up on Shabbat with the fellowship, with the worship, with the praise, with the corporate convocation that we're having an assembly together and strengthening each other and iron sharpening iron and praying for one another. On Shabbat, we should be so communal. We should be so together. We should be so united that we just like, you know, this afternoon we're having Bar Bat Mitzvah. I encourage you, even if you're not preparing for your Bar Bat Mitzvah, come anyway and commune with us this afternoon between 2 and 3 so you can have time and fellowship. Couples fellowship, be there. You know, if it's women's fellowship, ladies, be there. And hey, men, we're going to have to plan a trip up to the mountains or something and just commune together.
Yep.
Because we are meant to be stronger together than alone. Now, if we take a look at the book of Daniel, I love what it says here about the coming of the Messiah. This is the ultimate purpose why Messiah came. The reason that God raised up Moses and Joshua is the reason why he gave us Messiah. It says in Daniel 7:13, I was watching in the night visions, behold, one like a son of man, and it is actually Bar Enosh, the son of suffering. Enosh means mortal, a mortal, feeble, sick man. He took our sicknesses. He bore, right, our diseases. It says it's a descendant of Adam, but it's literally the one that realized they need to call upon the name of the Lord, Enosh. One like a son of man coming with the clouds of what?
Heaven.
So someone who looks human, but he's glorious with the clouds of heaven. That's an oxymoron right there. Because how can someone that looks human be flying in the air? So you see the vision of the man, he's saying he's called the Son of Man. That's a messianic title, Son of Man. Dr. Luke teaches us about the Son of Man more than any other gospel. But the concept is, he looks divine from the heavens, but he's human. This is a picture of the rabbis say of Messiah. According to Rashi, French Jewish commentator, who's most respected within Judaism, this is the Messiah in his verse. Absolutely, without a shadow of a doubt. Yeshua quotes this about himself. In Matthew 24. It's mentioned by John in Revelation chapter 1. And it's quoted many times in Luke. And that God will send Messiah, the Son of Man, with clouds of heaven. Which means with great authority and dominion. Let's keep reading. It says, coming with the clouds of heaven, he approached the Ancient of Days. Who's the Ancient of Days?
God
the Father. And was brought into his presence. So here's the Messiah. coming into his presence after some kind of battle. It says in verse 14, the first part it says here, dominion, glory, and sovereignty were given to him that all peoples, nations, and languages should what?
Serve
him. Now, let's take a look at the latter part of verse 14. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will never pass away, and his kingdom is one that will not be destroyed. Now think about the previous kingdom of David and Solomon. In a sense, it passed away or was destroyed. Right?
Yes.
The northern region of Israel was destroyed by the Assyrians in 722 BC, and Babylon destroyed Judah in 586 BC. So this prophecy makes no sense in Babylon that there's an everlasting kingdom, which we know the kingdom was destroyed by the Babylonians. But Daniel's being told in Babylon, don't worry, there's coming an everlasting kingdom that will never be destroyed. And we already said that Jewish commentators say this is the Messiah yet to come. And actually, this ministry of the Messiah is yet to come, because when Yeshua came the first time, he says, my kingdom is not of this world.
Amen.
So he set up a kingdom in the heart of men, not on earth. But when he comes again, he will come up to set up the physical, not the spiritual, the physical kingdom on earth. So it says, look at verse 18, but the Kedoshim, it says, the Kedoshim, or saints, which means the holy ones, of the Most High will receive the kingdom and what? Possess the kingdom forever. Yes, forever and ever. Not only does Messiah receive dominion, but he says, you as his kingdom of priests, we will possess the kingdom forever. So as Joshua possessed the land of Israel, we will possess the New Jerusalem. We will possess the whole world, because the kingdoms of this world shall become the kingdoms of our God and of his Messiah. His anointed one. That's Revelation chapter 11. Now, let's get ready for some Brit Hadashah. You ready?
Yes.
Let's take a look at the Brit Hadashah, because now we know we're supposed to possess the kingdom, possess those promises. I want to take you to Hebrews chapter 3, verse 7. I think this is perfectly aligning up with the Joshua story and what God promised through Moses, that they would enter to a land and possess it. It says, therefore, just as the Ruach HaKodesh says, that's the Holy Spirit, today if you will hear his voice, do not what? Harden your hearts as in the rebellion, in Hebrew, the merivah, which means the quarreling, found in Exodus 17, 1 through 7. On the day of testing, or masah, which is, masah actually is the Hebrew found in Exodus 17, 7, which translates to a test. They tested me. So they spiritually named the place merivah, which means quarreling, and masah, which means testing. So, it says this testing was in the wilderness. Verse 9, there your fathers put me to the what?
Test.
Though they saw my works or my miracles for 40 years, therefore I was provoked by that generation. And I said, they always go astray in their heart, and they have not known my what?
Ways.
My ways. Moses asked to know God's ways. Solomon asked to know God's ways. It's important for us to ask to know God's ways. Through the Messiah, we know his way, because he is the way, the truth, and the life, back to the
Amen.
Father. So he meant to show us the way back to him in teshuva, in repentance. So look at verse 11. It says, as I swore in my wrath, here's a quote from the Torah and the prophets, they shall not enter my what?
Rest.
Say that again, but really feel it. Say rest.
Rest.
No, do it with a deep breath, like with an exhale.
Rest.
That's what God wants for us. Rest. He says in verse 12, take care, brothers and sisters, that none of you has an evil heart of unbelief that falls away from the living God, but encourage one another. These are messianic believers. These are no longer Israelites per se in Israel or in Canaan land. This is you and I today, both Jew and Gentile. He says, encourage one another, especially because the book is Hebrews. It's speaking to Hebrew-speaking Jews, who are being told by Pharisees that there's no way Yeshua could be your high priest. And apologetically, the writer of Hebrews is telling us he is our high priest, but he's after a different order, the original one, by the guy who was first called a high priest, which is who?
Melchizedek.
And so when we understand that the people that he's talking to in this passage are 1,500 years since Moses. Notice that what applied to Moses still applies to that generation. And if you're reading it, that means it still applies to us today. You catching that? Let's read it together again. Let's read it at 13. Let's read this verse together. But encourage one another. Let's say it again. But encourage one another. One more time. But encourage one another. Not discourage. Let's encourage one another. Why? It's or when. Another day by day. Encourage one another day by day. As long as it is called Hayom, or today. That's how you say it in Hebrew, which means the day. So that none of you may be hardened by deceitfulness of sin. For we have become partners of Messiah. If we hold our original conviction firm until the end. As it is said, today if you hear his voice, do not hearken your heart, harden your hearts as in the rebellion. So what does he mean by this, if you hear his voice? What did Israel hear at Sinai? They heard his voice. So he's playing off of the Sinai experience. And saying, well, if you hear his voice, just like they heard his voice, don't harden your heart and build a golden calf as they did. Don't test the Lord as they did. Don't worship a rod lifted up. Look at it, but that bronze serpent lifted up, don't worship it. Worship the one who commanded the instruction for it for your healing. Don't worship the process. You know, many times in denominations, we've worshipped our golden calves. We've worshipped our bronze serpents. We'll even stick to, being called holy rollers in some churches. Yeah. Because at one time, someone in some Pentecostal charismatic meeting rolled on the floor, so we all thought we were supposed to all roll on the floor. And so people started mimicking that. And actually, Satan worshippers and mediums and sorcerers would come to almost mimic the gifts of the Spirit that were operating, just like Pharaoh's magicians would mimic the miracles of Moses. There are movements right now, I'm not going to name any because you'd probably get offended. There are movements right now where people are barking and laughing and punching people in the stomach and shaking people to the ground until they fall on the ground, saying that they're slain in the Spirit. Guess what? If the power of God touches you, so be it.
Yeah.
But no one should push you down on the ground and call it the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
No one. I don't care how anointed they are. Their hand is not that anointed that they have to do this to me.
Yes.
You know, or the, you know, like get the death grip there. You're like, push it into your forehead. You know, they used to say Catherine Kuhlman would barely, with her little tiny little tender finger, just barely touch someone and they'd feel the presence of God. And all. And I'm not here to validate, you know, Catherine Kuhlman or any other wolf man or woman of God, but I'm just saying, if it really is the Holy Spirit, let the Holy Spirit be the gentleman that he is. Let him be the comforter he is. Don't let him push people or force people. In fact, as preachers, we shouldn't push people. As rabbis and teachers, we shouldn't push people. We should encourage one another.
Amen.
You as ministry leaders and lay members within the congregation, do your ministry not with a push, but with a presence, with an influence that lets people know you love them. You're not pushing them.
Yeah.
Barbara, you can't push people to dance. They gotta wanna dance. I can't push people to worship. They gotta wanna worship. Even when I'm singing, I can't go, come on, sing! Sounds like a choir director, right? Come on, sing! I used to be in a mass choir where they actually did that to me one time. The guy was like screaming his lungs at me, and he wanted me to sing with a smile. I'm like, really? But you can't push people. You can't even push them into the promises of God. You gotta want it. You got to claim the promise that you feel in your heart is a yes and amen. That belongs to me. You're hearing something today. You say, that's for me, Rabbi. You're speaking right down my alley. You're telling me what I've been praying about and speaking about. Hey, I'm not telling you. He's telling you. I'm lips of clay. His words are eternal, not mine. All I can do is tell you what this wonderful word of God says. You have to claim the promise for yourself. Now, I'm going to show you in chapter 4, verse 1, how we claim the promise for ourselves. It says, let us fear then, though a promise of entering his rest is left open. You know when you leave options open too long, sometimes those doors close.
Amen.
You got to jump on the promise quickly. When God opens up a promise, you got to claim the promise. You can't sit around 2 years, 3 years later and say, well, one day that promise will come to pass. No, apply the promise to the problem now. Because even if you're not going to get that promise fulfilled a year from now, start practicing the presence and the promise and purpose of God now, so that one day you'll be ready to possess it. In other words, Israel, while you're in the wilderness, start applying the principles of the Torah now. So that when you go in, you'll be able to know. Yeah, God told us year after year, we rehearse the fact. He says, when we get to that land, we're going to sow seed in that land. And we're going to give God on the day of first fruits, the first fruits of our barley. Then we're going to give him the first fruits of our wheat. And then we're going to give him the final fruits of our harvest, the pomegranate, the grapes. We're going to remember that God told us this way back 40 years ago. And now we finally get to do it. So now that it's ingrained in your memory banks, and it's in your heart and your mind inscribed by the Holy Spirit, when it's time to really do it, it'll be easy.
Amen.
Isn't that what we do with our children?
Yes.
We impress the Shema. We impress it on their hearts. We literally grind it into their hearts like a scribe does on stone. Inscribe it into them so that when they grow up, they won't depart from what they've learned from us. So train up a child in the way they should go. In the way, the truth, the life. We're supposed to teach them that now before they ever possess it. Now, this is what it says in verse 2. Well, actually, let me finish verse 1. Some of you would seem to have fallen short. We all fall short of his glory, but we should not fall short of his promises. There's a promise that God is waiting for you to enter through. The door is open. If you wait too long, it's going to close. God opens doors that no man can shut. He shuts doors that no man can open. If God's put in your heart to serve in a certain area of ministry, let us know now. Don't say, well, I was going to tell you 3 years ago that I really wanted to make challah bread for... You'll save us a couple bucks at Panera. That's great. But if not, we'll keep going to Panera, because guess what? We're going to do what God has resourced us to be able to do. But if God's got a gift in you and you sit on it, guess what? You're robbing yourself and everybody else from the promise that God has for this congregation. How will we ever take that land that God has for us if we don't start applying the principles now?
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, look at verse 2. For we also have heard... We also have had good news proclaimed to us, meaning the gospel, just as they did. But the word they heard did not help them because they were not unified with those who listened in faith. But they were not unified with those who listened in faith, it says. For we who have trusted are entering into that what?
Rest.
It is just as God has said. So in my wrath I swore, here's the quote, they shall never what? Enter my rest. Even though his works were finished since the foundation of the world. In other words, God created the world in 6 days and he rested on the seventh. Well, where'd you get that, Rabbi? I read the next verse. Look at verse 4. It says, for somewhere he has spoken. How funny the writer says. Well, somewhere it said. It's called Genesis. For somewhere he has spoken about the seventh day in this way. And God rested on the seventh day from all his works. And again in this passage, they shall not enter my rest. So then it remains for some to enter into it. Yet those who formerly had good news proclaimed to them did not enter because of disobedience. Verse 8, for if Joshua had given them rest, oh, now we know it's absolutely connected to Israel because it mentions Joshua's name. How funny. Do you know the King James Bible? I think it's this passage that they put Jesus. You know why? Because they're the same name in Hebrew and Greek. Yehoshua in Hebrew, Aramaic Yeshua, and in Greek, Yesu. Now, when you think about this, yeah, it sounds like Jesus, right? When you think about this, how easy they were to mix things up. But obviously, the text is not talking about Jesus, or as we know him in Hebrew, Yeshua. He's actually talking about Joshua, because it's the same name, but the type and shadow is there. So as Joshua brought us into the land of promise, so Yeshua brings us into all the promises of God. Because he comes after Moses, just like Yeshua came as a prophet after Moses. Did you catch that one? That was a 747 right there. That was a good one. You should have jumped on that plane quick when you had a chance. Some good stuff. Now watch. Let me show you a revelation that you might not catch in your version. And this version, TLV, does clarify it. So there remains a what? Shabbat rest for the people of God. Now let me tell you what King James says. Good old King James. It's good enough for Jesus. It's good enough for me. I used to hear that as a kid. King James is good enough for Jesus. It's good enough for me. Well, Jesus didn't read King James. Because King James wasn't before Jesus or during his time. Yeshua never had a New Testament even. He only had the Hebrew scriptures.
That's right.
So this is what's amazing. It says, so there remains in Greek a sabbaton. The Greek word sabbaton is quoted in the Gospels every time as Sabbath. So Yeshua went to the synagogue on sabbaton as usual. In Acts, Paul goes to the synagogue on sabbaton as usual. It's the word Sabbath. It could be translated Sabbath keeping or the keeping of the Sabbath. But nonetheless, it's translated everywhere else Sabbath. How deceptive. How lined up with replacement theology it is, and how appeasing it is to just call it rest. Because everywhere else where the word rest is, it's a different word for rest. This is not rest like in the other portion. Other verses. This is Sabbath. So it doesn't say there's a rest for the people of God, so you can just make any day your day rest. It says there's still a Sabbath for the people of God. So this text says there's still a Sabbath rest. Complete Jewish Bible says there's still a Sabbath keeping for the people of God, I believe. Now, this is where it comes from. It's a direct quote from the Hebrew that talks about a Sabbath of complete rest, or in Hebrew, a Shabbat of Shabbats. It's called Shabbat Shabbaton. Say Shabbaton.
Shabbaton.
It means a Shabbat of Shabbats. A Shabbat rest of Shabbat rest. Or it's like saying King of Kings, Lord of Lords. It's a Hebraic way to say a rest of rest. A Sabbath of Sabbaths. So if anything, get all out of the Sabbath you're meant to get out of it. Because when you talk about your King, who's King of Kings, he's better than any king that came before him. He's Lord of Lords. All the lords before, they don't compare to the Lord of Lords. He has dominion over all of them. A Sabbath of Sabbaths. So it's translated sabbaton because in Greek they don't have the sh sound in Greek. So they're left with an S. And shabbaton is a direct transplant from Hebrew into the Greek and neutering it with the letter sheen becoming the S sound. And sabbaton gets translated rest, and it should be Sabbath. Amen. Write that in your Bible if it's not there. It should be a Sabbath rest. Now, what are we really saying? Are we saying that we should get legalistic and tell every Christian that they're wrong for worshiping on Sunday? No, because it's not wrong to worship on Sunday. Because every day is a day of worship. Amen. But there's only one day of rest.
Amen.
Because God commanded us, work 6 days, rest the seventh. Yeah. He didn't say, work 6 days and find some day to rest on. He says, the day of the Sabbath. It's set. And the Lord is the Lord of the Sabbath. That means after all your week, you've worked for your employer, now give me a whole day at the end of it to praise me for what I helped you accomplish all week long.
Amen.
And you're tired from the work you've done, so let me refresh you with my rest because I did the same. I modeled what you should represent. And you should work 6 days and rest on the seventh. Try to do this. Not only with your manna 6 days a week, try to see if you can get your week's goals accomplished in the 6 days.
Yep.
Instead of going, well, if I don't get it done, I can just do it Saturday. No, because then you make an excuse why not to come to some kind of show.
Right.
And then you don't get to see your brothers and sisters and worship together.
Right.
Because you're so tired, they're like, oh, I was too tired to go today. And sometimes we say we're sick when we're really just tired.
Yeah.
That's true.
Sick and tired. I don't know about you, but I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired on the Sabbath.
Yeah.
I want to be rejuvenated. Today I feel strong as an ox. No, like this. Strong like bull.
Yeah.
Because I've been allowing my week to be filled with a lot of work so that I'm so tired I go to bed Friday night. I'm just, you know, by Sunday I'm just ready to go. It was so nice to come home and just be like done. Even my message, everything. Just I was done with printing. I was done with everything. And it felt so good just enter into a perfect rest. And my wife was like, it looks so good to see you rested.
Yeah.
I said, yeah, I feel rested. And we just sat around and just enjoyed the presence of God. And I will have to admit, there are times where I'm still trying to get my thoughts together Friday night.
Yeah.
And I have decided I am no longer doing that.
Amen.
I'm going to rest with you.
Yep.
I'm going to enjoy my Shabbat with you.
Amen.
And I want you to enjoy it with me. Amen?
Amen.
How are we going to do that? Let's finish this passage and then we're done today. In verse 11 it says, let us therefore make every effort to enter that what?
Rest.
That rest. So the Sabbath is a model of that rest, but it's not the rest. So just because you come here on Shabbat doesn't mean you're resting.
Right.
You can come here very anxious and not be resting. So what the Sabbath is an eternal picture of the rest, which is spiritual, that God wants you to embrace and to receive in your spirit, man. You can physically come here on Shabbat and say, I kept the Sabbath. It doesn't mean you're spiritually resting.
Right.
Think about how many times you left here frustrated. Oh, man. Think of the times where you actually just grumbled and complained while you're here. Oh, why are they doing that? Why? I don't like this. Aren't we just a bunch of Israelites in the wilderness still?
Yes.
Oh, this is the promised land. No, it's not. Not when we're grumbling and complaining.
Right.
We walk away more mad than when we came. Why come and be frustrated? Why not enjoy this? This is such a blessing to be here. I thank God every time I get to drive an hour to get here.
Yes.
It's joyful to walk through that, drive through that wilderness.
Yes.
From Indio to San Jacinto. Come on. Like, I love this. It says, so that no one may fall through the same pattern of disobedience. Wow. Verse 12. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword. It pierces right through the separation of soul and spirit and joints and marrow and is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of our hearts, that no creature is hidden from him. But all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account.
Amen.
And I close with this passage, 2 Corinthians 1:20. For in him all the promises of God are what?
Yes.
And therefore also through him is the amen by us to the glory of God. Now it is God who establishes us with you in Messiah. We're partakers of Messiah. He anointed us, set his seal on us, gave us the Ruach, the Spirit, in our hearts as a pledge, as an earnest of the guarantee. Wait a minute, isn't he modeling the Israelites?
Yeah.
That God gave us Moses as our leader, just like he gave us Messiah today. That he gave us an anointing over our life. Didn't he allow the same Spirit that came upon Moses to come upon the elders of Israel and they began to prophesy? Didn't he tell the whole nation, I want you to just be kings and priests unto me, not just the Levites? Didn't he really want them to all be ministers of reconciliation? Did he want all of them to receive that? Well, how about this one? He set a seal on us. Didn't he call all of us Israelites as chosen? He put a seal upon them as chosen people. Am Segulah. Wait a minute. He gave them the Ruach. Didn't the Spirit of God show up to give them the Torah in their hearts as well as the Torah on stone?
Mm-hmm.
Didn't he give them the Torah the way he gave it to us in our hearts?
Yeah.
Isn't it the same picture? It is. Dayenu, if he would have just brought us out of Egypt. Dayenu, if he would have come on, brought us to the Red Sea. Dayenu, if he would have brought us to Mount Sinai. Dayenu, if he would have just brought us to hear the Torah. Dayenu, if he would have just, you know, get us through the wilderness to the promised land. Dayenu. But guess what? If he would have just given us Shabbat. Dayenu. But bless the Lord, he gave us all these things. And Dayenu, he gave us Messiah too.
Amen.
It would have been enough, the Hebrew term means. Dayenu. Sufficient that he's in our hearts. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Today I want you to write down these four things that I want you to walk away with about the promises of God and possessing them. Number one, Hashem's servants must have their ears nailed to the door.
Yeah.
You're going to serve here at some point, Yeshua? Nail your ear to the door. Open your ear up and hear where you can serve and be obedient to God's covenant, where you can find a niche, a spot, where you can do something that makes you feel fulfilled when you come. Have your ear nailed to the door. Be hearing what God wants you to do in his house, to be a servant of God. Second, Hashem circumcises his servants to become sons. See, when they were in Egypt, they were slaves. When they left Egypt, they became his servants. But when they entered the promised land, they were circumcised as sons. Slaves to servants to sons. Hashem drives out the enemies that try to block our promise. So once you've been circumcised in your heart, you become a son of the house. God says, I will drive out the enemy that tries to block your promise. And lastly, Hashem allows his chosen to enter the rest of Messiah and claim all his promises. That in him, all the promises of God are yes and amen.
Amen.
You receive that today?
Yes.
How many are ready to receive that promise?
Amen.
This week, starting with tomorrow, we're going to be looking at offerings, the atonement cover of the mercy seat, the menorah with its seven lamps, the pattern, Holy of Holies, or the holiest of all, the altar, and then Rabbi Eric's going to preach a message called Sanctuary of the Heart. I cover your prayers because next week while I'm gone, I'll be at the MJA conference and be a part of the Torah service there, and that's an honor to do that. And then right after lunch that day, when we all fellowship for lunch, those that are coming, we'll have a 2 o'clock class, and I'm going to be teaching on the double portion of Elisha that he received from Elijah. Would you stand today? If you receive this message, would you just bless the Lord?
Amen.
I said, if you receive this message, would you just bless the Lord?
Amen.
Stretch your hands for the blessing. As you bless him, he also continues to bless you. Amen. Yivarechecha Adonai v'yishmarecha. Ya'er Adonai panav elecha v'yihonecha. Yisa Adonai panav elecha v'yasim lecha. Shalom. Amen. May the Lord Adonai bless and keep you. May he shine his face upon you and be gracious to you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you perfect peace. And Sar Shalom, the Prince of Peace. Establish peace for you, your children, and your children's children. For his namesake in love, we pray all these blessings in the name of Yeshua the Messiah. B'Shem Yeshua. Amen. God bless you today. Amen.